regreso aquí en Auto 060, una edición especial del evento Nissan 360 que se celebró en Newport Beach, en California, donde la Nissan, como decíamos y hemos escuchado en los primeros dos segmentos, presenta todos los productos que fabrica y vende alrededor del mundo, los que ya están en producción, los que ya están en venta, pero también los prototipos y todas las tecnologías nuevas que tiene Nissan para el futuro. Y estando ahí, me tocó la suerte de estar en la ronda, en el wave, como se llama en inglés, donde vinieron los periodistas del Japón, y entre ellos vino un periodista, un colega inglés que se llama Peter Lyon, que es el co-chair del premio al auto mundial del año, y con cual compartimos la experiencia de Nissan 360, y también un poco aprovechamos la oportunidad para hablar un poco más de cómo se ve la industria de los autos de Estados Unidos desde Japón y algunos otros temas. Así que escuchemos la entrevista con Peter Lyon que realizamos durante el evento Nissan 360 allá en California.
Peter, how are you? You are the co-chair of the World Car of the Year Award.
That's right, yes.
And I'm very honored to be accepted this year, so thank
we're,
you.
We're you had honored to have you with us. We're honored to have you with us.
Thank you very much for that. And I was, I couldn't make it to Nissan 360 before on the American wave, but I'm really lucky to join the Japanese wave because it's more interesting being like a Japanese car manufacturer and like find you here too, so I'm happy for that.
Yes, it's this event is the third one so far. They did the first one in San Francisco, second one in Portugal, but this one is interesting in that they've created like a mini Disneyland inside an airstrip, which is quite interesting. You've got the off-road course, which is very well done. You've got the up, so you can do hill climb and descent in the performance. But I think what people really want to see here are, of course, the cars they cannot drive in Japan, because there are a lot of cars that you can't, special cars that are made for China, Indonesia, the Americas, Europe, even South America, that we just cannot drive back in Japan.
So that's very interesting, and the opposite for me, because I've been driving like the little cars, like the little Japanese cars, like the taxi cab and all that, so it's very interesting for me. So Nissan in Japan and in the world, really, I mean, it's like second or, well, in Japan it's the third one, right? Toyota, Honda, and then Nissan?
Well, Nissan is said to be second. Nissan and Honda are very close, but Nissan sells a few more cars than Honda, yeah. And of course, Nissan have a lot more product coming out in the next few months, few years, something like 50 cars or something in the next few years.
They said like one car every 6 weeks around the world.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. And I mean, when you look at what Nissan's been doing recently, it's quite impressive. Not just the new cars that they're bringing out onto the market, but the way they're growing the brand. They're launching into racing. Now they are a main sponsor, Infiniti. Infiniti brand, Red Bull. They're back in Australia now with the V8 supercars. They're competing in Europe with the GTR GT3 at Nürburgring, for example. They're competing at Le Mans with the electric car.
And maybe we'll come from NASCAR with the Altima or the Maxima.
Why not? Because that's where they want to go. Because they've also, as you know, they've also created the Nissan GT Academy, which is doing very well. And I'm very, very pleased to see how they keep growing that. They didn't just keep it as a game of become real world racer type of thing. They're growing it so that now
the first
gamer to become a real world racer, of course, he stood on the podium at Le Mans the year after he won.
That's incredible.
He became a champion, and now he's the test driver for their next generation electric race car, the Zeod. That can you imagine this guy's life? I think they're making a movie out of it, aren't they?
Well, they should. If they aren't, they should.
I think they are. Yeah. But it's great to see, you know, a young kid who is just loved playing games, and now he's a real-world racing driver getting on the podium.
Nissan is smart at like reaching to those kind of people, because they're the future drivers and buyers of cars, right, around the world.
Yeah, but I think one of the main things you see here that everyone wants to drive, the Japanese press want to drive, are the big trucks.
Yeah, because they're quite different markets, huh?
Yeah, very different. I mean, in Japan, especially for the last 10 years, most manufacturers have been basically focusing on minivans and K-cars. K-cars are the small 660 tiny cars. So when you look at the lineup of cars made by the Japanese manufacturers, the vast percentage are made up of minivans and minicars. So you don't see many sports cars, you don't see many coupes, for example, you don't see many... Well, they're coming out with a few more SUVs, but it's really focused on minivans and K cars. And now, what I'm very happy to see is Honda. What Honda's done in the last 6 months, they've said they're coming back to Formula One.
Yep.
They are going to announce the NSX very soon. Well, they've been showing us what they're going to do with it. Now they're going to bring it out to the market very soon. The technology in that is quite amazing.
Hybrid car, yeah.
Really great to see what's happening with the front wheel, the in-wheel motors. It's four-wheel drive, the hybrid. It's got about 400 horsepower. It looks good. I think it's getting better. Each time we see it, it looks better. And, of course, they have a Type R as well that they're bringing out. It's at the Nürburgring now. They're trying to make it the fastest front-wheel drive car around the Nürburgring to beat the Megane RS.
Yeah.
So, you know, they're showing their pedigree, their racing DNA, because they, as you know, they were huge with McLaren 20 years ago.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, that, you know, they have all this knowledge and championships under their belt.
Yeah. Came up and all that. So, Peter, you've been living in Japan, I understand, about 25 years?
That's right, yeah. And long time.
I've been an automotive reporter there.
Yep.
How is the Japanese media and public in general perception of the U.S. market? Like, bigger cars, bigger roads, more traffic, more gas guzzlers. How do they see us?
Well, you've just basically said it all in one sentence there. But what the Japanese see when they see an American car is there's still a slight perception, even though American cars have become a lot more reliable, a lot safer, they drive a lot better, they handle, they can actually corner now. Whereas up until 10 years ago, most Japanese would not even think about an American car because it doesn't go around a corner very well. But now they corner well, they're reliable, you know, they don't break down like they used to. They're not as big as they used to be, they're more fuel efficient. But the trouble is that the American name does not have a good sort of sound in Japan. It doesn't. It only sells maybe 1 to 2% of the market in Japan. It's very small.
Any particular model popular there?
GM
not
has
really.
Probably the best GM and Ford. Ford have some cars. The focus is on the market now. GM have a few cars. We're looking forward to the new Corvette.
Yeah.
Everyone seems to be looking forward to that. Apart from that, there's not that many cars that sell, not many American cars sell well. And of course, you won't get any trucks in Japan because the roads will not take
the
cars.
They won't even fit, right?
I think when Japanese look at a foreign brand, a non-Japanese brand, it has to have some sort of cachet to it. It has to have some presence, some brand integrity
to it. It has to be better. That's what they do.
So that's why French cars, for example, as they sell reasonably well, but they don't have the brand sort of loyalty and strength that
the Mercedes,
BMWs, Porsches have. See, Japanese see German cars and they think one rank above, and so that's why they pay the extra money. But American cars, they're big. Most of them are big. They're clumsy, difficult to get around corners in Japan. But of course, when you come here,
they fit the roads.
Yeah. One thing you notice here that you don't really notice in Japan is when you come up to the stoplights in the States, you come up and you're surrounded by a wall of SUVs and trucks.
Whereas you can hardly see around. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. In Japan, it's minivans and K cars. So it's a totally different mentality.
Yeah. Very interesting event. So unfortunately, we're running out of time here because radio, I mean, it's killer right here, but. So, going back a little bit to the World Car of the Year Award, they're not showing anything new here, but do you see any candidates here?
Any candidates here?
I mean, the latest thing is the Q50, I guess, which is pretty good, Infinity.
The Q50,
but it's not the World Car of the Year because it's not everywhere, right?
To be a candidate for the World Car of the Year, you have to be available on two continents and in five countries.
Yeah.
And basically, the way that most judges see the awards, they want to look at the eligible cars in terms of not just design, handling, reliability, safety, and environmental issues. They want to see the car in terms of buyability. Can the normal man in the street buy this car? Is it not too expensive? It has to be in a certain price range.
A value equation.
Yeah. So it's very difficult for a car to win that, you know, is priced over, say, $60,000.
Yeah.
I think, because even if we have a great car, like, for example, the new Mercedes S-Class, it seemed to be a very, very high-quality car with the new autonomous driving system. But something that's priced over $100,000, some jurors might think, you know, great technology looks good, all of that, but you can't really put it at the top of your rankings because it's priced too high.
Well, we'll
I think the cars that we have given the awards to have been worthy so far.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. Volkswagen has been big in latest years.
Yeah, exactly. One thing that I hope people notice is that we've been going for 10 years now, and when you look at the past winners, they've all been either German or Japanese. Which says something. Most jurors will say that the Japanese and the Germans are making the best cars at the moment, but I think the Koreans are coming along very quickly. The Kia and Hyundai are doing very well. Some of the design we see, the handling, the performance is wonderful. The safety measures are great. And also, I think there are some American cars that are coming a long way. I mean, for example, the Chevrolet Impala has got
The Fusion is pretty good, too.
Wrap recently. And of course, the Corvette, I think, is going to star because it's priced so well.
I know. It's a lot of car for not that much money.
Can't wait to drive that. Yeah.
Exactly. Well, Peter, thank you very much for your time. And we'll wait for that list. And we'll see you at the auto shows and in New York for the big announcement next year.
Yes, for certain. See you there.
Thank you very much.
Esa fue la entrevista con Peter Lyon. Pueden encontrar sus publicaciones en Motor Trend, en Auto US Express, en Inglaterra, en Autobleed, en muchos sitios. Así que busquen a Peter Lyon, uno de los colegas del World Car of the Year Award. Y ya regresamos en esta edición especial de Auto 060 con Nissan 360.